talking about Han's newest hero, of course, to enter New Earth, and that being the one and only Parallax. Parallax, joining New Earth here recently. This is actually a hero that's of your creation.
It is.
And first off, here, I'm getting ahead of myself. In case you don't know, I'm Breaking CBK. And I'm also joined by the one and only Wham Pow.
What's up, guys?
I call you Chad, but.
That's okay, too.
Wham Pow is what you like to be called. It's really
I've
weird.
I've been called worse, so either one is good for me.
Anyway, so Wham Pow, we actually had you on for Deadlift as well. Deadlift
yes.
was your hero, correct?
Yes, well, that was so. A coordination between a lot of people, Locke in particular as well.
Okay, that's right, that's right. So this one, so Parallax was really your creation then from kind of the beginning. And
yes.
So it is a little bit different for you in this sense where it was yours,
yes,
your inception.
Definitely have some attachment to this particular hero.
Good.
Took a while to get him in there, but pretty happy with him.
Yeah. Pretty happy with him. I mean, as far as he's been out for what? about a week now.
Yep.
A little over a week here. Have you been pretty pleased with what you've seen so far? I mean, have there...
Well, I'm happy with the play numbers for sure. I would like to see some win percentages increase a bit. Hopefully with some changes upcoming, we can remedy that.
Can you guys not hear him? Maybe I need to turn the mic up one sec. Let me do that here. Just a little bit. There we go. You should be able to hear him a little bit better now. Anyways, as you were saying.
So, yes, I think with some upcoming changes that we should see a substantial increase there. So, hopefully that problem will be remedied.
All right. Well, we'll get into that a little bit later. First, though, we want to obviously... So, as we do here in these discussions, guys, what we do, we... Basically, I was given a random game here. Honestly, I haven't even watched it myself. I was told it was a pretty good Parallax game, though.
Okay.
I was told it was a pretty good Parallax game. So, we're going to go ahead and kind of have it on screen at least while we're, well, basically discussing Parallax and talking about the hero. So, in fact, let's go ahead and make it from his perspective just to give it even a... better feel here, but all right. So Parallax again. This is like your inception, basically from the. What was the idea with Parallax in the beginning? What were you going for? With
so
this hero?
Initially, my goal, I was kind of analyzing the, you know, what current heroes we had. I was looking for, you know, different positions that we could kind of fill out that weren't like inundated with a particular type of hero.
Mm-hmm.
I really wanted to build a caster carry. Somebody who carried not through auto attack like many of our characters do, and actually carry through abilities.
Okay.
That proved to be a very challenging endeavor. A lot of iteration with this guy. In fact, actually, the initial implementation, he actually had three different fulcrums that he could use and manipulate.
Okay.
But this is a very high skill.
Chad is saying that they can't hear.
Yeah, yeah. I'm trying to figure. Okay, they can't hear you apparently. Okay, one second. I'm doing everything I can, guys. Calm down. Jesus. All right. I don't want to blow it out, though. Okay,
right.
Here. There we go. See, I'm a loud person, so. Okay, let's see if this is better.
How's this, guys? Is it a lot better?
There we go. Yeah, maybe if you just scoot up there. That should be good.
So his initial iteration, he actually had three different fulcrums he could use and manipulate. Unfortunately, that became entirely too complex of a hero to actually utilize, and he still maintains a lot of this high skill cap play,
yeah,
even with one fulcrum. But again, my initial goal was to build an int caster carry, and that actually kind of makes things different for typical int heroes that rely primarily on their burst early game. And I think that throws some people off initially because they come in like, oh, it's a int carry, or it's an int caster, he's able to blow people up. Really not solid early game.
Yeah.
But I kind of tried to flip that script a bit and build this carry that is going to struggle a little bit in the early laning phase, but come late game, he's a monster.
Okay. So you mentioned the idea that he was going to have three fulcrums in the beginning?
His initial the initial concept, he had multiple fulcrums to be able to like dash to, manipulate, throw around the map.
Okay.
It was intense.
Yeah. So how is that like, I always find that interesting how there's so many, obviously, the process isn't as simple as you come up with an idea and that's how it sticks the whole way through. I mean, as you're pointing out here, you know, it had its iterations in the beginning, you kind of got a feel for it, and then eventually you got to where it is now. But is that almost frustrating as a designer? You start with this idea and then it constantly changes, or is that a cool thing, you think? Like,
for me, it's more like I come in with the notion that what I've made the very first time is probably not going to be what the end product is like. I just kind of have that mindset going in that it's an iterative process. It's something that, you know, maybe I haven't, like, foreseen every possible interaction that's going to be have with all the other heroes in the game and say, hey, we just can't have that. These things need to change. This isn't as fun or as interactive that we want. We need more counterplay here. We need more, you know, we need more damage here. I get a lot of feedback just from watching people play and interact with them because I see this guy and all heroes as this kind of tool of interaction for players.
Okay. Cool, cool. Okay, so let's talk about specifics here of Parallax. As you see, now he's middle lane. First off, right off the bat, is that where you would expect Parallax to be?
Yes, and then through SBT testing, this is kind of where we saw his role lie as
okay.
well.
So, again, the ultimate idea is that, again, on paper, what you designed him around was that an intelligence hard carry, correct? Okay. So, well, he's right here, actually. Might be in trouble, but nope, never mind. He's got an ability to escape with. And that kind of leads us into the fulcrum. The fulcrum is the synergy of this hero. This is where this hero really, everything revolves around the fulcrum, of course.
Yes. And part of the hero is he's very weak, and he has this very, like, fragile, like, look about him and feel. And what we were trying to, like, capture is all his power comes from the fulcrum. His interaction and manipulation of the fulcrum is where his power actually lies.
Yeah.
He himself is not physically powerful.
Okay. So he's just, he's a wimp, really. But,
yeah.
It's,
but
he's a badass with
a
big gun, basically.
Exactly.
Like, or, like, yeah. So, okay. The fulcrum, what I found very interesting when I was first looking at this hero, the fulcrum itself, untargetable. You can't do anything to it if you're an enemy, basically. It's all on Parallax to control it. As the enemy, you have no choice but to accept it, basically.
That's
or,
true.
You know, move around it. What was that ever a thing? Were you ever able to interact with the fulcrum as an enemy, or was that always something you wanted to stick with? And
That was a very deliberate design goal for me. When there's something for you to attack, players tend to want to destroy that thing. And sometimes they'll go out of their way to destroy it just because they can.
Yeah.
And I wanted it to be something where they know it's something that's there and they need to play around, but it's more in the back of their mind as far as having to try to like interact with it or destroy it, and they need to worry about Parallax and not always be focusing on the fulcrum like to take it out.
Okay.
And that was a very explicit goal.
Okay, so yeah, you see right here again, you start out with the level one of it again. It's what the hero's really, it is the hero in essence, as you're kind of getting at, so that's what really matters there. What about the lore, by the way? This destroyer of worlds, this alien guy that, you know, comes to New Earth and basically just is gonna take over and say, I mean, what, did you have any involvement in the lore, or was that, is that other people? Is that Jeremy Brown?
I mean, Jay Brown, great writer. I definitely had some input, but that's his magic.
Okay.
That's his magic. But yeah, the whole like concept of this like cosmic locus.
Yeah.
I early like it resonated with me.
Yeah. It's really when you're designing the hero, is that something you think about too? Like at least a little bit of the lore? Is that just an afterthought for you? You're just worried about the skills in the game and you know the.
Well, as best as I can, I try to work in a theme, at least initially. Like, for example, this guy's initial theme from my design perspective was more like this magneto manipulation of metal and magnetism, and that was kind of my general theme coming in.
Okay.
But Jay Brown is, you know...
Beware.
We're gonna make this awesome, okay? So I'm like, hey,
fair
it's better in your hands for sure, and you know, working with content and working with concept artists, we were able to make something really, really cool.
Yeah, very cool, very cool. Okay, so we talked about the fulcrum here again, so that's what the hero's designed around. We'll talk about the W now. The Ionic Dash, I believe it's called, if I'm not mistaken. Ionic Dash here. So this ability is interesting. We even saw it in play already. You know, it's a great getaway tool. It's also good for jumping in with. It silences people. It does the magic damage. It basically allows him to interact with the fulcrum as far as, you know, porting to it. So where did this ability come from?
So, again, initially this wasn't even an ability that I had on the onset. It was something that we kind of threw in testing and said, you know, this guy doesn't have very much survivability. Let's try to give him a little bit more mobility and just kind of see where it goes. And just the pure playmaking ability with that particular ability alone was just so fun to watch.
Yeah.
Like the big plays that you can do with this guy is so entertaining to me. And so it stayed.
Yeah. It makes him quite a skill cap here. I mean, this hero is pretty skill intensive in my opinion, and I think that's where it starts with the Ionic Dash specifically. It because the idea of it, you know, it is a port, but it's a port that requires a setup initially.
Exactly.
It's not like other ports where you just hit the button and then you can just port with it. You see here, you actually made fall Lord Self Wars, man. That's a whole another subject. But anyway, so so was that intended that you wanted it to kind of be a skill shot in a sense and give another difficulty to the hero?
Absolutely. It was something that I didn't want to make another blink, so I wanted to have more interaction and more setup on the player's part where I need to know where my fulcrum is, I need to know where I'm sending it and where I'm going to go with it, as opposed to I'm just going to pick some area around me and I'm going to get there. The other part was to kind of curb his mobility in a sense. So in order to really escape instead of like, you know, a hag blink, it requires two skills for him to get away. And that was to kind of help bring the mobility down on this particular hero.
Okay. Okay. His third ability, the Dark Mana here. Now, this is an interesting one because it really has kind of two points to it. So it's one of the ideas is obviously the magic damage you do and you get the charges, which increases his mana pool, and we'll get into that just a little bit here with the ultimate, of course. But on top of that, though, it then does this funky thing with the losing mana if you're within radius of the fulcrum. So, well, why combine the multiple abilities like that into one? Because you could have just gone with the charges and left it at that.
And actually, initially we did have just the passive, and the passive was pretty much all we had for a while. Working with Element User a lot, we decided that it needed just a little bit more flavor to it. We wanted to go harken back to zoning potential of the fulcrum, because we kind of had lost that through some of the iterations. And so we wanted to try to incorporate something that would have more some soft zoning tools. We didn't want to do a mana burn. That tends to be very, very frustrating from a player perspective. We didn't want to steal it. We didn't want to drain it and kind of step on the toes of some other heroes that can do so. So this was more about a mana erosion and being next to the fulcrum and kind of like bringing that down for the enemy player, where they can clearly see there's this, you know, this circle kind of emanating out of it, and they have a chance to play around it, and it's really a good zoning tool earlier on when your mana pool is pretty low. So when people are trying to get their last hits, you can maybe you're not actually doing direct damage to them, but you're, you know, getting them off the creep wave.
Yeah, you know, we're kind of noticing this guy right here glancing over, not 100% paying attention to be honest, but you see right here actually going to be using that Ionic very Dash nice. Of his. It's not going to get the kill though. A little bit delayed right there, and unable to chase. We'll see if he's able. There you go, the fulcrum. Nope, can't get it out. Did he not silence him? I don't know if he actually silenced Dr. Repulsion right there, because he was able to ludicrous speed away. Anyways, so in the laning phase, something you probably want to keep in mind then, speaking of the passive, is to use that fulcrum with the mana burn sense of keeping it towards them, basically, keeping it near them, because, you know, why not? Again, it can't be destroyed, it can't be targeted, and it's not going to push a creep wave, because it doesn't do damage to the creeps unless on the initial use, but that makes sense. You want to position it next to heroes in the laning phase.
Try to zone them off it as best you can. And then there's always that kind of fear that at any moment he can hit Q again and move it right through me and do damage. So it's this kind of like ever present fear of damage.
That's true. By the way, guys, feel free to ask questions in chat. We'll do our best to kind of glance over and read chat here and answer any questions that you may have concerning Parallax here. We're going to obviously focus on that. That's what this segment's here about. So if you do have any questions about Parallax, then we got the man who designed it himself here. Who better, right? So, so now this leads us into the ultimate, which you just happened to pick up right there. So some good timing. We're talking about Earthshatter. Earthshatter is the ability that brings it all together, as ultimates tend to do. Again, synergy with the fulcrum, but this also has synergy with the passive, of course, in the sense that the more mana you have, the more damage you'll ideally do. So kind of go over this ability here. Like, where did this conception come from of
Earthshatter? We're trying to, out of all the iterations, like, all the different things we tried to change on Parallax, I think the majority of iteration actually came through. Ooh, that was really nice, Cass.
Yeah.
That was well played. We went through many different ultimates for this guy, a lot of them. And we were trying to find the best way to, like you said, build the synergy between the rest of his abilities, use the mana to his advantage. And what we kind of came up with is the ability to do damage based on the difference between the max mana of yourself and your opponent. Because of the charges that you get off of your E passive and the reward of being aggressive and hitting enemy heroes, you can build up a very massive pool of mana. Mm-hmm. Not to mention this kind of itemization of this particular hero, going icon, great locket, things like that build up a lot of max mana. I've seen games where he gets 3k, 4k mana if he's, you know, if he's rolling, and he can just
obliterate the team. Yes. Because of that difference. So, okay. Yeah, this is the ability, again, as ultimates tend to be, the kind of bringing the hero together. This is, I'm sure you've seen it, a lot of the criticism where that's coming from in terms of where people that say, you know, maybe this isn't as strong as they thought it would be. And how would you address that as far as his ultimate? Is it a little weak, maybe? I mean, I know you did talk about, again, we'll get into it a little bit later here, as far as you do have some changes in mind that we perhaps want to talk about as far as that are coming to Parallax. But, you know, one of the examples that people are bringing up on Jedi notices, and I've heard this before, is that it's kind of like a torture ultimate, but with a cooldown, with a massive cooldown. Obviously, it's not exactly the same. I mean, this has the ability to do much more damage, of course.
A lot more damage, and the mobility of being able to change the shape and size and position of that damage area.
Yeah.
As a big kind of differentiating factor between him and Torture specifically.
Okay. Is it as... Okay, well, let's go this route then. I know this was a discussion that was had, because I was even part of it myself a couple times, on the hero with the ultimate. It's magic damage. That's the idea of creating a spellcasting hero with carry potential. It does seem a little bit difficult when a shrunken head can counter that. Where was the decision that ended up to be, you know what, we wanted to not work against shrunken heads, make it magic damage rather than superior magic?
That was quite a debate within the design team, absolutely. At the end of the day, for us, like, first of all, that in SBT, this guy was destroying people.
Okay.
I would make a, you know, chain, try to, like, bring down his power level, and it would feel like I didn't do anything. He would just roll through people. And we finally got to a point where, like, we need to do some tangible changes to him to really break the balance. Some good plays there.
Yeah. The fulcrum.
We wanted to, like, we were trying to figure out the best way to kind of cope with the amount of power that he could get in the late game. And still add some counterplay as well. So we decided, you know, maybe he doesn't need the superior magic damage, because in the late game, as you know, the shrunken head kind of goes down in duration, his max mana pool should be so large enough that it'll last longer than shrunken head will.
Okay.
So, granted, they're going to get, you know, at minimum, I think it's 5 seconds or 6 seconds of shrunken head.
5 seconds minimum, yeah, so 5 to 10 seconds would be the duration.
He was going to be able, with his max mana pool, have somewhere 13 seconds on.
Okay.
So, and he's cutting it in half, but even at that amount of time, being in that area for 5 to 6 seconds is a tremendous amount of damage. I mean, it's 180 damage minimum plus 4 damage for every 100 mana difference. I mean, you can get up to 260 to 300 damage.
Okay.
Per second.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, so that is interesting, you know, hearing that, again, in SBT, you're having to tone this guy down constantly and whatnot. So, now, again, a way as a designer, I'm sure, to kind of notice how things are looking, what you may need to look to change or whatever. Whenever you release a new hero, of course, it's going to be heavily monitored, basically, is what I'm getting at. The win percentage of this hero right now, it does seem a little low. It's pretty low.
It was a lot lower than I anticipated. Yeah. I kind of figured it would be lower, just, again, the skill cap that we've been
talking about. Because of the skill cap,
yeah. And just, he's very fragile. His movement speed is pretty low. It's 290. So I knew it was going to take some time for people to kind of get the handle of this guy and really be able to make him shine.
Okay.
I was not anticipating in the 30s.
Well, see, that's a good point that you bring up, though. Again, it's... You can't overreact at the same time. Like, yeah, it is a fairly lower win percentage, but the point you made out there and was very clear to me from the beginning, and I would hope to a lot of people out there, again, this is a pretty skill intensive hero with that fulcrum, with the maneuvering of it, with the synergy of the Ionic Dash, but also the ultimate for that matter. I mean, you can't just freely use your ultimate, you know, whenever you feel, obviously it has a fairly longer cooldown, but positioning of it, you know, and to be fair as well, because he doesn't himself have a stun of sorts, he doesn't have a lockdown,
right.
So he is reliant on his team as well.
Absolutely.
So that's where the synergy comes in, like a Behemoth, a Tempest, If you have that, I bet its win percentage goes through the roof, honestly. But
and it is very team dependent as far as keeping people locked inside that area of effect. Absolutely. Mm-hmm. And that was another conscious decision, is that we wanted to give him some CC ability to keep them inside there. But because of the mobility and his ability to manipulate its position pretty freely,
yeah.
We didn't want to get him any really hard CC like that and lock someone down and have like pretty much no chance of getting away. But if it was something that was deemed through team coordination and through picks of any particular hero like a Behemoth and locking them down, that was completely fine with us. That's great synergy with teammates.
Okay. You know, there are multiple heroes. One that really comes to mind as far as being a competitively valuable hero that's in the right hands can be very good, but in TMM games, just doesn't not necessarily as good. Ophelia is one that kind of comes to mind, mm-hmm. For me at least. In the right hands, in a competitor's hands, in a competitive tier match, and she's a very popular pickup, of course, she's a very powerful hero. Mm-hmm. But on the TMM scene, where, you know, where players aren't as skilled and, you know, aren't able to micro as powerful as those top-tier players, and they're not going to be as high win percentage, of course. Do you think Parallax might be similar to that? Again, it comes back to the idea that there is coordination involved in, and if that's the case, would you be fine with that? That in the higher skill cap range, like, he is actually very viable? Or do you want to see him good at all levels? And
I mean, like, again, coming down to it, he has a niche pick because of the skill cap. And I like to see the pick shine in the right hands for sure. I mean, again, going in, I knew this was not going to be everybody's cup of tea as far as the skill was concerned.
Yeah.
Part of the issue is because people can dash into fights.
Waste of time.
People kind of cowboy YOLO swag in sometimes, and yeah. They just get blown up.
Yeah.
And I think it takes a mindset to say, hey,
you're not a tank.
Right. I need somebody else to initiate or start this fight, and then I'm going to follow up with this QR combo and clean everyone up. And I think it takes some little bit of time to, like, rear yourself in, because you always want to just go in there, do your damage, kill everybody, and walk away. And that's not exactly this guy's playstyle.
Okay.
You need to have this finesse. You have to have the consciousness to, like, hold yourself back at times and not just bust in there.
Yeah. Yeah, no, the design's definitely very interesting. And actually, it's a good point. It's being brought up Archangel here in chat. You also got to keep in mind, win percentage could be also a little bit lower because there's a couple of heroes recently that got some pretty significant changes and buffs that are being played quite a bit and doing pretty well. Not pointing any fingers or anything. Over there, maybe, but Wild Soul and Hellbringer doing crazy things now.
I mean, they're definitely doing work, and it's for him in particular, I can see where it'd be kind of hard to keep up at times. For
yeah,
sure.
Yeah.
But
that's fair. Okay, so let's talk about the not only what this guy's doing here this game. You know, he seems like he's doing all right at least. It's actually a pretty even game so far. You look at the build that he has. He went Steam Boots into a Ring of Sorcery. Is this kind of what you would expect out of a Parallax player? Is this an efficient build, you think? Or?
I mean, it's pretty efficient. I don't normally see Ring of the Teacher all that much. Usually it gets built into, like, Great Blocket first.
Oh, you mean Ring of Sorcery?
Yes.
Okay.
Usually I see a Great Blocket as one of the first more kind of major items being picked up early on. But anything giving you max mana or keeping your mana up is definitely a good pickup for sure.
It makes sense.
Absolutely.
You want to have the higher mana pool, and yeah, oh jeez.
Wow.
Those mines doing some work. You want to have that more mana, obviously, for the power of your ultimate, and it seems like the go-to item choice is an Icon of the Goddess, because that's one you're kind of talking about, and obviously Ring of Source, that's where it can be pretty powerful, because you can split it up. We see that players do it all the time, and then turn it into an icon. So wouldn't be surprised to see that here. But yeah, Icon, and was that intended, you know,
yes,
from the beginning?
Yes, I mean, Icon is quintessential in this guy. It gives him, you know, the tenuous that he needs, and gives him a huge spike in his max mana.
Yeah. Okay, but from there, is there anything that comes to mind for you as far as item build? What do you think is a good late game build on this guy?
I've seen some people go Grimoire. I've seen other people get, you know, they also pick up Sacrificial Stone. They go Sheep Stick. Sometimes they also go, you know, Hellflower if they want more of the CC to keep people in.
Yeah. trying to chase down right there, so. But what was the question? Oh, yeah, this is always a fun one here. With a new hero especially, the idea of a Staff of the Master and being possible. It's not currently on him, of course.
It's not currently on him. My idea
Superior Magic?
Maybe bring in a second fulcrum. Maybe kind of harken back to some initial design.
Second fulcrum. Guy, you want to even make him that much more skill cap heavy? Jeez, having to control two fulcrums.
All these different damage areas being manipulated at the same time, and it'd be so fun to watch.
That could be pretty fun. So it's just something you're kind of toying with. Nothing that's
Nothing concrete, guys.
Really,
nothing
concrete. Okay, fair enough. All right, so. Again, this actually seems like a pretty evenly matched, but it goes back to the synergy that we're talking about. They do have a Behemoth, as well as a Moira even, so it seems like there could be, something there, but they also have a Wild Soul, so.
Ooh, that's true.
The win is probably near for these guys, to be honest, so. Let's just talk about this part now. You've mentioned that, possible changes are coming to this hero.
Yes.
You've had a little bit of time to absorb what's happened now and everything. You want to give us some insight here as maybe what we could expect?
I can probably divulge a couple little
changes
here. I mean,
for everything.
I read the forums daily, multiple times a day. I look at the feedback that we're receiving, and you know, when we're trying to buff this guy up and to determine if he needs it, first of all, we make sure to look through all that first. Some of the changes that we were looking at, some of the big ones that kind of kept sticking out, and this is actually a change that was happening towards the end where we kind of reduced his range of his fulcrum shift, his Q.
Okay.
So we're actually going to be increasing that back up and a little bit more so. So we're actually increasing the range of the Q, the fulcrum shift, from 700 to 900.
Okay, so that's the range you can
actually cast
it. Okay, cool.
We're also increasing the leash range, so after you break a certain distance away from the fulcrum, it will teleport to you.
Yeah.
So we're actually increasing that from 1100 to 1200, so that way on your cast you still have some playroom before it would actually teleport back to you. So this should kind of help keep him safe and be able to harass a little bit easier. In doing so, we're also increasing the range of the W, the Ionic Dash. So that's going to go from 725 to 925.
So that'll compensate for the
Q. So nice. We always want to be able to Q and W at the same time. Like we
that's
did.
A long blink.
It is. It's pretty
is that like the longest blink? Because I'm trying to think of like you got Hag, Mage Bane. Those are the two obvious ones off the. What are their blink ranges? Because I would be curious.
It's
because that
pretty
must
far.
Be up there.
Now, again, it's not a complete blink in the sense that he still can be targeted during his dash. He's not disjointed.
Okay, 1150 for Mage Bane, so it is a little bit longer for him. No, that's true, though. Yeah, it's not a complete blink by any means. Sorry, I'm kind of just nerding out here. So those are both 1150. Okay, so it's not as steep as those.
Correct. Now, again, part of the W that we didn't mention is if you do hit an enemy hero, it does reset the cooldown of the ability. So if you actually time your position properly as you're sailing through people, you can, you know, get a double blink and get pretty far away from people.
Okay. Yeah, no, in comparison, yeah, you're right. Things like Chrono Sleep, Valkyrie Leap, yeah, I guess it's not, for some reason that just sounded like it was ridiculously long, but it's not 7,000 Valkyrie Arrow range
no,
by any means. So
no.
That's just ridiculous. That's just, yeah. Anyways, okay, cool. So there's that. Is anything else, or?
We have some more changes coming in. I don't want to divulge too much.
No?
Maybe I'll throw one more in there.
There's something else you can give.
Making some changes to Earthshatter is ultimate. Probably one of the bigger ones. We're reducing the percent max mana costs. So it's at 5% currently.
Okay.
We're actually changing that to 3% max mana per second. So this should help substantially
that
in the
adds
early
up.
Game.
Yeah.
Have way more mana to cast abilities early on. This should help tremendously, in my opinion.
Yeah. That adds up quite a bit. For sure.
I mean,
okay.
It's going to increase the duration that Earthshatter can be on, and like I said, the ability to cast more abilities while it's on before you go. So.
Yeah. What was the idea with making a percentage base? Why not a flat mana base?
So basically, it was more a consistency issue. So initially, it was flat, and then you would just build up 3K, 4K max mana, and then that cost was like nothing. You could have it on almost infinitely.
Exactly. What's so wrong with that?
People didn't like dying all the time.
Easily, yeah. Okay.
So to keep a consistency among the actual duration of the ultimate, even still building up the max mana, it kept the times consistent, so we could, it had a lot easier time balancing it.
Okay. All right. It's a good thing I'm not a designer. So I just feel like, you know what, just leave it. It's fine.
Spear magic damage that doesn't actually ever turn off. I mean, it's unbalanced.
That would have been my direction, yes. I was an advocate of that. No, but yeah, again, I can see in the right hands. You see the lineup he's old. That's another thing to keep. Again, this is a very niche hero, and this is also where that skill kind of comes into play. You don't just want to pick him up any given game just because you want to play him. I mean, sure, do that if you want, because have fun at the end. Of course,
fun to play.
But you also not only want to look at your team synergy, because we're talking about that earlier with like a Tempest, a Behemoth, you know, those ideas there. But then who you're going up against as well is pretty important.
Because it is very important.
Of his ultimate, how it interacts. You see here, he's going up against, like, a Dr. Repulsor, so probably not usually a hero you'd want to really look to. But at the same time, he has a silence, so I guess that could be pretty good against a doctor.
Well, at this point, what you have to understand is that the ultimate on somebody like, you know, Dr. Repulsor isn't going to do the kind of damage that it can do to other heroes. He builds up quite a mana pool himself, so it's not going to do as much damage as you're going to find against, you know, strength heroes, for example. Like, if that kind of a lineup is what you're going to be encountering, he's a great pick. He's going to destroy people.
Yeah.
But he's not an anti-mage in that sense.
Okay.
He's not going to do that kind of damage. Now, the Q is still going to do tremendous bursts. It can, as you get later into the game, because it does a percentage of your max mana on top of the flat amount of damage.
Oh, the Fulcrum does? Okay.
Yeah, so it does 10% of your max mana plus a flat amount.
The Legion have destroyed a Hellborn Tower.
Later on, it does some damage.
So we're
looking
at, right now it's what? It's 1,700 mana, so you're looking at 170 mana plus 85. Am I doing the math correctly, or?
Damage-wise? So you're looking at...
it's 10% of max mana, so...
Yep,
yeah, so it's this number here, right? Yeah.
Plus, okay. 85.
Oh, it's the max mana that you currently have?
It's your actual, not your current mana, your actual max mana. So it'd be...
1,700.
Yeah, it'd be...
Okay.
The percentage is 1,774 plus the 85.
Plus 85, yeah, okay. So yeah. Leave it in my mouth, right? 10% of that 170. Yeah, okay. Okay, so, but that goes back to you look at the 3,000 mana pools that you're talking about that you could definitely get up to.
Right, so I mean, you're looking at 300 to 400 magic damage there that has two charges. I mean, you can drop, pre-mitigation, obviously, you can drop up to...
I want to watch that fight again real quickly, actually. Let's see what Significant does here. So this is actually, one of the first bigger fights I've seen. He uses his Fulcrum there, he kind of goes in, I see a couple of kills off the bat, but then here's that ulti in progress. And look at Dr. Pulsar, he's taking some good damage.
And the nice thing what he's doing, he's actually using the full length of his tether before it's supposed to teleport to him.
Yeah.
So it elongates the damage area, and to me, I always had this vision of it kind of like clock hands. So he gets the increased movement speed and actually can run around and change where the damage area is going to be.
Okay. Yeah, I found that design also really interesting when I first saw that. What was the idea? Because you could have just gone with a box. You could have gone with with the more obvious shape, but you went with that.
This teardrop shape.
Yeah, the teardrop. What? Why?
Again, it was kind of a flavor thing. We wanted to try to make some of these different kinds of shapes and build in. One of the new techs for us is actually being able to change certain AOE sizes through distance. This particular way, it hadn't been done. With an effector specifically, so we were trying to utilize that new change and build in this kind of teardrop shape that could be manipulated and moved around.
Yeah. Again, I see a couple people constantly bringing up the Torturer comparison. What would you say makes him different than... Because Torturer's an interesting hero. There already are some obvious differences. Torturer has a stun for one, and is seen more as a support style hero than an actual hard carry, which is the ultimate goal of this. And to be fair, Parallax, with the way his ulti scales, it's a lot more hard carry potential than a Torturer, just a flat amount.
Right. And but, he has two scaling features, his Q and his ultimate.
And the Q is, you're right, what the Fulcrum Mage were just mentioning. So, I guess is that ultimately the fact that he just scales with his abilities?
I mean, I even think that max damage-wise, he even at a flat amount, he's even higher than Torturer's. I think his max on his R is 150, I believe.
Okay.
And his max is already at 180 plus all the scaling feature on top of it. So, he has more damage. And the other point of it is, he can change that position, he can change the size, he can get an entire team and not have to be in it.
Okay. Alright, another big fight right here. I mean, it's still take unnecessary. Looks like, Grimoire Power, also, obviously, another item that Seems like pretty big on this guy. Mm-hmm. The increased damage, the nice little intelligence boost on top of that. So, yeah, you see the 47 charge. It's what, 120 max charges, right?
That's correct.
That you could potentially get. So, what would you be comfortable to see? Like knowing that he has 47 charges here, does that make sense to you? Like, is
that's
that
about
where you're
that's
comfortable
about where we were
zone?
Seeing it.
Okay.
In the early iteration, he actually never lost charges on death.
Oh, really? Okay.
It was a problem because people would just go in, try to do as much, try to get as many charges as possible and die.
Yeah.
And they knew that eventually, I'm going to get enough charges just to take this game over.
Yeah.
So we try to add this counterplay in so that way it would kind of de-incentivize this whole just jump in, get blown up, but eventually I'm still going to, you know, outskill you.
Yeah.
So you have to be, again, more conscious of your positioning. You need to be more conscious of actually busting into a team fight like that. Mm-hmm. And kind of leading with your fulcrum.
Yeah. Do you, by the way, McRivals, there was a comic really? That came out on Parallax. You can check that out. There's the whole backstory and everything. So there wasn't one in the spotlight. We didn't have that in the beginning of the spotlight, unfortunately, this time around. But there is actually a background and everything. And we
yes.
talked about that earlier. Jeremy Brownie, as always, does a great job with creating these stories and giving you a way to really be able to get a good feeling of what the hero is and where he comes from. But I believe that I'm not even going to say what, because I don't want to ruin this story, but it's just, well, he's an alien, I'll say that.
Yes.
There's the one thing I'm for certain of.
And I'm pretty sure Andromeda is somewhere in there as well.
It's Andromeda ties in, yeah, so who knows? Who knows where all that will lead, but... yeah, it seems, and this continues to actually be a pretty even game here. No obvious leads at this point just yet. So yeah, I know, you mentioned even before you didn't lose charges. Now it's only five charges at this point, too, up to five charges. So that's really not even a lot, as well. So
it was more of a concern in the early game that we didn't want to like completely demolish your charges. Have you like had to build up only maybe 6 to 9 in the early game, and
okay.
just being able to cut that right off. So that's why we have like the 20% or 5. So we didn't want it to be like completely devastating, but if you keep Parallax down, you can shut him down in the early game pretty well.
So okay, yeah, that's, you know, when designing a hero, obviously there's gonna be weak points too. Not that we want to overstate, like, you know, well, here's the weak point. This is how you deal with Parallax. And mm-hmm. but what are his weak points? If we had to say them, I mean.
Well, again, he's pretty fragile, and yeah. especially early on, he doesn't have a tremendous amount of move speed. Depending on how people skill up their abilities, some people go Q and E to kind of like get as many started getting the charges as early as possible because they want to scale in faster.
Yeah.
But at a detriment of his mobility and his escape. So if your positioning isn't spot on, you know, getting ganked is pretty detrimental.
Okay, so he's just fragile. He's
fragile. The other point is silences, especially through his ult. One of the built-in counterplays we did was if he's silenced during the cast of his Earth Shatter, he actually gets suppressed, where he doesn't consume mana, but his ult won't do any damage. So it's very beneficial to have someone who can silence or buy a Hellflower that when he casts it, as soon as he's casting it, you kind of shut him down.
So if you silence him while he's channeling it, it won't actually stop the channel?
It won't stop the channel, but it won't do any damage.
So it won't do any damage, but then but it still will burn mana?
It won't burn mana.
No, it won't burn mana. Okay. But then after the silence is over, then it'll go back to doing damage. Okay, so you can keep it on. Okay.
Yes.
What if he gets stunned then? If he gets stunned, it turns off.
It doesn't work the same way for stuns.
Okay, that's what I thought. Okay.
Just silence.
So it's just the silence.
We did test it with stuns as well, but that seemed just way too much counterplay at that point.
Okay, gotcha. Yeah. It really does seem like he's a very fragile, because again, you obviously have good reason to believe that the idea of superior magic on the ultimate was probably just going to be a little too over the top. It's not like you're just making a decision on the whim and being like, you know what, no, I wanted to be magic damage just because. I mean, you guys did a lot of practice with this and took a lot of time, so.
And again, what it came down to is that he was still being able to take over games regardless if it was superior magic damage or not.
Okay.
He was still just wrecking people, and they were still, it wasn't even superior magic damage at that point. So
yeah.
Saying, well, obviously, it's not a necessity on this hero to be successful, and we want to be very conscious about where we put superior magic damage on what things,
of course,
on what
yeah.
heroes. It's not something that we would just want to throw on, you know, willy-nilly on any
just
hero.
Just because,
so
yeah.
If it absolutely stopped him from being able to carry, and we would put that kind of, at least have another discussion about it. But the fact of the matter was, he was still doing very, very well without it.
Okay. Okay, so nothing like that's happening yet, but as you mentioned, you do have some good changes coming. All those are buffs, of course, and we'll see how that interacts with the hero moving forward and as far as what he can do here in the near future. But yeah, it seems like he's starting to get a little bit of a roll going here. Yeah, nearly up to 3,000 mana, as you see, the icon and the Grimoire that he has picked up. And again, this is that kind of average game that you would expect for a decent Parallax to be doing.
And so, I mean, he's got 77 charges at this point. I mean, that's some significant mana.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah, well, how much does he charge at? It's
11.
So, 11. Yeah. Quick math right there. I don't know what it is, but it's a lot. There you go. It's a little over 800. And, yeah, that's just from a passive ability, let alone the items on top of that, of course. So, yeah, it seems like he found his groove here and kind of snowballed. So, yeah, you see the icon, of course, and that's also kicking in with the charges. But
and especially, like, once you get some solid amount of charges, your Q and W combo can just eat through people quick ways. Like, you can farm up very, very quickly and just... They're just
fodder
at that
point. Yeah. So, let's talk about Mid Wars here. Now, this hero's really broken in Mid Wars.
Oh, is that the perception?
I would assume so. This guy seems like he'd be really powerful in Mid Wars.
I mean,
I actually haven't tried it yet, but
I haven't seen too many Mid Wars games. I've heard he's been pretty successful.
Okay.
I can't speak a whole lot about that.
Yeah.
I can say in CTF mode that I've seen some pretty solid Parallax
pretty
plays.
Good, yeah.
Probably you. So, I mean,
Alright. Alright, yeah, no, it seems like on paper you should be pretty good at Mid Wars, but of course that goes back to where, you know, that's not what you're necessarily designing around either, so.
Yes. Yes.
Makes sense. Okay, but there you go, guys. That was a Parallax game right there. Got a pretty, an average idea. Again, the Grimoire, the icon. It seems like he overall did pretty solid there. You know, made some decent plays and got a good idea. Well, again, I believe that was around an 1800 game, if I'm not mistaken. So that wasn't a low-level MMR game by any means. So
no, he made some pretty clutch plays. He was really good with his positioning and the fulcrum positioning.
Yeah.
So
yeah,
keeping people in the Earth Shatter is key.
Yeah. All right, so the changes that you're talking about, I mean, is that something that we can expect here soon, or?
That's supposed to be patching in next week.
Okay.
So expect that, and hope people continue to play him and see, really get to see the power he can do.
Yeah. If you haven't tried him yet, or if you have and maybe you weren't the most impressed with him, then, well, try him the next patch, and we'll see what happens with that. But, yeah, I really have a feeling this is going to be one of those Dark Horse heroes that people really may be underestimating, because again, they're looking at this flat number right here and they're saying, oh, you know, it's not doing too well. What is it at right now? Yeah, 32%. So
yep.
It's yeah, but in the right hands, as far as skill cap goes, I really think he's actually one of the highest in the game.
Mm-hmm.
As far as that's, there's just so many reasons for that, with the microing of the fulcrum, knowing when it's best to use that ultimate and how to position it and everything. So, and like, when this hero becomes eligible for competitive play, I could definitely see him being a niche but powerful one at that. So I'm excited for that. But
I'm excited for that.
Yeah, I'm excited for that. All right. So, but anyways, is there anything else you want to say about Parallax here?
I mean, I think that pretty much went over him pretty well, I think.
Yeah.
I think so.
We covered the guy pretty well, and he's obviously been in about a week now, guys, so definitely check him out if you haven't, and get some fun with Parallax. And again, Wampow here joining me, the creator of Parallax, and more heroes to come, I'm sure.
Absolutely.
More to come, so.
Absolutely.
You got any leaks you want to tell us here?
Nothing yet. I think I
divulged
enough today for me.
Okay. Okay. We're not bringing NG Turret back, are we?
Not that I know of.
Waz has said it.
I mean, Waz, anything, he hears Turret, and I mean, his ears prick up, and I mean, yeah, let's do it.
Oh,
it's a
Waza.
Turret. Let's do it.
Oh, Waza. Okay, it doesn't look like we're missing anything here as far as questions go. No, I think we should be good. Okay, guys, so what we're going to be doing here, we're going to be going on a short break. Going to keep the stream on.
Any giveaway before we...
Oh, yeah, good point. You know what? You want to do a giveaway. Let's do a giveaway. What are we giving away?
I'm saying Parallax All Avatar, maybe High Priestess.
The High Priestess Parallax Avatar. We can do that. What do we want the keyword to be? That's the important question.
Keyword's going to be hashtag Chadboys with a Z.
Chadboy. I've seen people That's you. You're the one that's to blame.
Yeah.
Hashtag Chad Boys, like that?
Yep, that's
okay.
It.
Okay. Here we go. Here we go. This is for the Parallax Avatar, High Priestess. Oh, God. Is Stopbot... Nope, don't do it yet, guys. Stopbot's feeling me. Hold on. Stopbot, where are you? Everyone's saying Chad Boys now. And there's no giveaway going on. We can just randomly choose. Why isn't Stopbot working? Let me try it this way. Keyword running. Okay, I think Stopbot's broken. Alright, so we'll have to do it a different way here. One second. Let's do it this way. There's Twitch has its own thing.
Oh, okay.
I think. Wait, how does this work? It's currently broken. GG. You just had to do a giveaway, didn't you?
I'm sorry.
You just had to do one. I don't know why this isn't even working either. This chat is too small to... What? An open giveaway's here. Alright, let's do this. Let's do this. So since the Stopbot's not working, let's do trivia. What can we do for trivia? Can we do a parallax question? Maybe see who was listening in chat?
We can
do, Okay. Here we go. Okay. Alright, let's see who's listening, who kind of knows the hero here. I'm gonna actually ask it in chat as well, so people's streams are maybe delayed. It won't be as, bad for them. Okay, Okay, the question is, there you go. How many max charges can Parallax have on his passive? There you go.
Yeah, there you go.
That was a pretty easy one, to be fair. Naughty Smurf.
Nice.
The one and only Naughty Smurf with the win right there. So Naughty Smurf,
Chat boys? Your
first
Chat boys?
On the list. Okay. Naughty Smurf, if you want to go ahead and... message Honcast your in-game name. We'll get you that avatar as soon as possible. So there you go. There's the giveaway.
Congrats, Naughty Smurf.
Okay, message Honcast if you want that avatar. Anyways, so thanks again, man. Always
appreciate
fun.
Appreciate it. Thanks
always
for having
a pleasure.
Me on.
And we're gonna be doing our thing here now. So get out of here. Right?
I'm out.
Just kidding. Anyway, so yeah, Parallax. Looking forward to that. Hey, may you replace the Parallax today in your honor. We'll see.
Awesome. Thanks, guys.
All right, guys. So that's Wampel there. Let me readjust some things now. Okay, so what we're going to do, guys, we're going to go on a short break here. Because I got to set up now for the next part of today. And that being matches. We're going to be playing some matches here. If you haven't heard just yet, there's actually a post about it on HauntTour.com. Let me actually pull it up myself. The Hauntiversary Showdown, as it's being called here. We got a couple of teams that we created. Myself being one of the captains. Waza being the other team captain. And we actually are joining forces with a couple of pro players, as well as a couple of people from the office. And we're gonna be playing some Haunt, basically. We're going to be playing ultimately a best-of-five series. It's actually going to start on... the five maps are Mid-Wars, Capture the Flag, Blitz Mode, Grimm's Hunt, and Force of Caldivar, if it comes to it. So we're going to be doing a best of five of that. We're going to be having some fun, really. That's what it's all about. I'm going to be streaming from my perspective here. As far as the teams go, yeah, let me list them off. So it's myself. It's going to be myself, Milkfat, Root of Z, Baba Ganoush, and Nier. Easy win, no matter who we're playing. But the other team, Team Waza, it's Waza, Ace Jr., Krake, Probusk, and Shorkan. So... like I said, easy win for us, but we'll try to make it entertaining on top of that. Of course, yeah, this will be uploaded on YouTube as always when it comes to these streams. So here's the post, by the way, that has the information on it. So anyways, guys, we're going to take a short break. I'm going to play some music right here. I have it coming up screen and everything. But we're going to get set up for this, and we're going to be having some fun here playing some Han. I believe also, not only am I going to be streaming my point of view here on HanCast, but Znui is actually going to be doing some spectator point of view as well as casting it even. I believe he's even going to be joined by What You Got over on his stream. So twitch.tv/Znui, you can check it out. And they're going to be casting these matches. So if you want to watch it from the perspective of a spectator, you can check out his stream there. So anyways, guys, going on a short break. Stay tuned. We'll be right back. More Han action coming at you. Should be some fun here. Stay tuned.